Did Mark E. Peterson really say that salvation can only come through the church? Next on the Ex-Mormon Files. Hi, and welcome to another episode of the Ex-Mormon Files. I'm your host, Bishop Earle, and I appreciate you spending some time with us. This time we have Stephen Farrell, who's been willing to come, and we've actually had a hard time getting you scheduled.
Yes, we have.
Between so many things. But I'm sure I appreciate him coming down and sharing his story. And
Thank you.
I'm thinking that we might be able to visit for a couple of times with you on this, just because you've got such an interesting story. And it, in so many ways, parallels mine, too. So I guess maybe that's what interests me. Your family is very active in the church. And
yes, very active on both sides.
This, where was this at?
On my side of the family, my dad was a convert to the church.
Oh.
From Catholicism.
And what area of the country was this at?
Back east.
Was it?
Yeah.
Okay.
And my mom, I believe we go back 5 generations. We have polygamous stock in our family.
Oh, very proud of that, aren't you?
Yes, yeah. Very proud. And then on my wife's side, 5th generation on both sides.
Wow.
Very strong LDS family.
Okay. So back east is where you grew up?
We grew up in Henderson, Nevada.
Oh,
yes, of all places. There's actually a strong LDS population in Henderson.
In Henderson, okay.
Yeah, and so it was good upbringing. And
now, I'm sorry, I missed how the East Coast came into it.
Oh, that was where my father's from.
Oh, that's where his family was from.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And then he came out here. And so you were born, raised in Henderson?
I was born here in Salt Lake.
Okay.
My dad was in the military, and we moved around a lot when I was young. But in my, I was 7, 8 years old when we moved to Nevada, and that's where I reside for up until the end of high school.
Okay. And brothers and sisters, how many?
7 siblings.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Where do you fit in?
I'm right in the middle.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, the middle child.
Yes. We're the troublemakers.
I've got one of those. He is the troublemaker.
There's a reason why I'm on this show. I'm the middle child.
And are they all active in the church still?
All but my sister and I.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. So growing up, you just went to church all the time, I guess.
And, yeah. Every Sunday, we had family prayer every night. Home and evening on Mondays.
Oh boy.
Yes.
Baptized at age 8.
Baptized at age 8. Didn't know what that meant at the time, but
isn't that funny?
But I got to go swimming for a couple minutes.
Yeah. And then deacon, teacher, priest. I guess you did that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Went through different ordinations at the appropriate age,
Scouting.
Scouting.
Yeah. Oh, boy. So this is all you knew.
It was, yeah.
You didn't know any Christians, or did you know Christians?
Most of my friends were not LDS.
Oh, is that right?
Growing up,
okay.
And so I strayed off the path a couple times in my youth.
Got in the wrong friends?
Yeah,
wrong
crowd. Did things I'm not proud of. But I always... I grew up in the culture of Mormonism, so that's all I knew.
Yeah.
And I didn't have a testimony in my youth of Mormonism, but I believed there was a God, and I believed this was the true church. I just didn't have a very strong testimony of that.
Oh, really?
Until later in my 20s.
Did you take seminary?
I did, just a couple years of seminary.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was early morning, 6 a.m.
Oh, that's tough, isn't
yeah.
it? Yeah. But not having a testimony, you're just kind of going through the motions then?
Yeah, I think it was more out of fear. You know, fear of, God's going to strike me down.
Of mom and dad, though?
Yeah. And not, not being looked upon, by members of the church, just in a positive way. There's a lot of fear around, being Mormon and living the right standards.
Anxiety.
A lot of anxieties, definitely.
So you come after high school, and what happens?
After high school, I go to college.
Okay.
And I start a semester in Idaho, and that's where I met my wife, was in Idaho.
Pocatello,
Idaho, yeah.
Okay.
And at that time, I was living the college life, doing things that most college students do that are not LDS.
LDS standards.
Yeah, okay. And I at that point I decided that I needed to figure things out.
Yeah.
And I wanted to turn my life over to God.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And
you made that conscious kind of a decision?
Yes. I was 18 at the time.
What prompted that?
Just didn't like the way I was...
Woke up one morning.
...feeling. And yeah, I knew there was something better out there for me. And you know, when you're in first semester of college, you're doing a little bit of soul searching.
Sure.
You know, you're kind of trying to find your way. And so mm-hmm. that's what I did. And I just got down on next to my bed and prayed and just said, I told God I'm sorry for all the things I've done.
Good for you.
And I'm willing to do what he wants me to do.
Okay. And what did that look like?
Well, I was taught that was Mormonism. That's what that looked like. So I just became a better Mormon.
Yeah, right.
Lived the commandments and went to church and paid my tithing. And
just did the whole thing. Did you go through the temple?
Yeah, so my wife and I was actually getting ready for a mission.
Oh, okay.
And this beautiful girl, I came into the cell phone store and I was working there trying to sell cell phones, make a quick buck. And she came in looking for a better plan.
Yeah.
And, you know, she, instead of walking out with a 2-year agreement, she got a lifetime contract.
Yeah.
But I fell in love with her head over heels. And she was actually very inactive at the time. She didn't have very good feelings about the church at that time in her life, even though she grew up LDS.
Really?
And so I brought her over to...
Tried to teach her, bring her back to the church.
And so we got married civilly and then worked really hard for 2 years to get settled in the temple. Hmm. And so we did 2 years later.
Yeah. And did she, then you remained active?
We did. We remained very active members. And, at that point, I personally wanted to just come closer to God. And my patriarchal blessing, it had all these amazing promises in it. And I didn't see any of them come to fruition. And so I just knew I had to be a better Mormon. And
that you weren't doing enough, huh?
Yeah.
We don't talk too much about the patriarchal blessing. How old were you when you got that?
It was when I was 19.
Was it?
Yeah.
Just before you?
When I was getting ready to get ready for a mission.
And did it, it is interesting what it says and how those things.
Yeah, and with mine, it was, gave me a pretty specific plan for my life.
Yeah.
Which I thought, this is great. Like, I know exactly what I need to do. And, didn't quite work out that way.
Well, now you went through the temple with your wife, and I do usually ask her quite often, what did you think of the temple, and what did your wife think of it?
Yeah, when we went through the temple, this is, I didn't know what to expect because they don't teach you in temple prep class what to expect.
No, they don't talk to you about it.
And I really thought, like, when we were going through the temple, there were some things that I thought, okay, this is. I can see why people think we're a cult. There's some
really?
Weird things, yeah.
Yeah.
But at the part where you go into the celestial room and the instruction at the veil, I truly thought like I was going to see like angels or have some sort of spiritual experience on the other side of the veil.
Yeah.
And I get in there and it's just a full room. It's loud. It's not very special, and it definitely broke my heart. I thought,
oh, really?
This was the experience that I've been working for my whole life, and
everybody talks about, and that's where you're.
Yeah,
that's
and
the
I
big...
just thought this was not special at all.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, it was hard, but I put that behind me, and I thought I'll just keep going.
Did you share that with your wife? What did?
No, I didn't. And,
yeah.
And my wife.
We don't want to do that too
you're
much,
not,
right?
Well, you're
you don't
told not to
hurt anybody's feelings or.
Yeah.
Did
my
she
wife,
enjoy it?
It freaked her out.
Oh.
She read these anti-Mormon books as a teenager, and she's like, that doesn't happen in the temple. And so when she got in there, she was freaked out. She's like. She didn't tell me that, though, until years later. I should have got the hint, though, when she never would go to the temple with me.
Oh.
I'd have to drag her out of the house to get her to go. And, but, yeah.
Mm.
It But I kept going, and those feelings that I had that were really off-putting, they went away. Like the more I went, I just got used to it.
Yeah.
And so it's really interesting. I forget how awkward and uncomfortable and not very spiritual that the temple is.
Interesting. Now you become very active. I mean, you hold callings. So what kind of callings do you have over the next few years?
So I've had every calling you can think of, a scoutmaster, elders quorum president, Sunday school president,
really?
Sunday school teacher, ward missionaries, whole bunch of callings, and eventually second counselor in the bishopric was my most recent calling
before
I entered my faith crisis.
Yeah. And during that time, anything about the church that, again, you had to put on a shelf, so to speak, or?
Yeah, leading up to in when I was around 26, 27 years old, life was just getting really hard.
Mm.
And most people experience, hard times in their life, and this was just a normal hard time that we were having in our life and our marriage. And so I decided to just double down, and I read the Book of Mormon straight over a weekend, and I read it every week for months.
Yeah,
I read it 13 times in a year.
Oh my goodness!
And yeah.
Oh,
I know.
Really?
Yeah, 13 times. For me, it was a born again experience. Like I really felt Christ back in my life. And I read the Bible during this process too.
Oh my goodness. Old and New Testament?
Old and New Testament.
And okay.
And I started seeing the contradictions.
Oh, you did?
From the Bible to the Book of Mormon. And I thought, okay, we're taught there's translation errors, so I'll just...
Can't trust the Bible. So,
So the good things in the Bible I'm going to keep. And the rest that contradict the Book of Mormon I'm throwing out.
Of course, that's what we all do.
And so that was one of my first shelf items. Like, that's odd.
Yeah.
And then I learned that the Dead Sea Scrolls were like 99% accurate to, the King James Version that we have. So I thought, well, where's the translation errors there? The Dead Sea Scrolls were
pretty
spot on.
Where's that list of errors? Huh?
Yeah.
And this is a good active member of the church then.
Yeah, very much so. But it was a small line item, a small crack that... It's just how it is.
There's got to be an answer.
I won't have it in this life. I'll have it in the next.
Yeah.
And, but...
Now, what did you teach in Sunday school? Was it a gospel doctrine?
Yeah, as a Sunday school president, I would teach.
Oh, sure.
Teacher's teaching, but, we did Old Testament. We did the Book of Mormon. We did Doctrine and Covenants. Over the years, it was a different scripture we'd focus on, different book.
Yeah. And what did you think of Jesus at this point?
Jesus was never a big part of teaching in Sunday school. We would talk about, the attributes of Jesus and living a Christ-like life.
Yeah.
But all the talks were centered around modern-day prophets and what we do as a church versus what Christ has done.
Yeah.
And we always taught what the church, about the church and prophets, not necessarily Christ as much.
Now, I've heard that so many times, and I believe that. But the Mormons must think that that's not true. We talk about Jesus all the time. Do they think that?
When I was a strong, believing, true blue Mormon, I believed everything was around Christ, not realizing that everything we did was for the church and not Christ.
Yeah, either about
even
the church
at the temple,
or about
you're promising
us.
to the church, not
isn't
you're making
that,
promises to church, not Christ.
Didn't I always thought that was funny? That one point where we give all of our time, talents, and energy, and everything we have to the building up of the kingdom of God here on the earth. That's the
that should have been my first hint.
That should have been, and I heard that one, many, many years ago, and never rang a bell.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask a kind of a different, just escape me. It'll come back, I'm sure, if God wants me to ask, I'm sure it will. But you know, we just have this kind of, especially in the temple, as I've said many times, Jesus seems like kind of an errand boy and not really
We're equal heirs to Christ as members of the LDS Church.
Yeah, all about us.
Yeah.
And what we're going to achieve and what we're going to make. And just, he's just our elder brother, and he came along first. And
right. He was just the lucky one.
Yeah. It's just the funniest little concept. Well, anyway, that whatever it was is gone. So anyway, but you had a testimony.
So when I had that born-again experience, I had a testimony. And reading the Book of Mormon as many times as I did, the stories of repentance and forgiveness that are everywhere in the Book of Mormon,
if you
get past of all the wars and bloodshed and, you know, things like that. And that really spoke to me, like, wow, God, like, if God can forgive the worst, then he can forgive me.
Yeah.
And so that was an amazing experience. And so I'll always contribute that experience to Mormonism. And, you know, maybe if I grew up in a Christian church, I would have got that experience a lot faster than at the age of 26, 27.
Well, for sure, because like you say, and like we've said, many more people come and think they've had this relationship with Jesus, but they really don't know who he is, or at least they come to know who a different is. Yeah. I guess one big question is, did you ever understand grace as a Mormon?
No, I never did. And I thought it was funny that the Christian church could claim that that's how they would be saved, like by grace. I thought that was so silly. Like, so you're just going to say you're saved and you can go now cheat on your wife and go commit all these crimes and God will still accept you in his kingdom? And that was what I always thought grace meant to me.
Yeah.
You have to work for your salvation.
That's right. And that's all that, really, that's all you hear in the church is what we have to do.
And that, to your intro, salvation comes through the church by Mark E. Peterson. That's what he taught. That's what our church leaders teach.
Yeah, I actually looked that up, and it's in the Ensign in July of 1973. He said that.
Yes.
It was written in there. And there are some other quotes that Bruce R. McConkie and some others have said that are just as outlandish in the sense of it's through the church.
Only through the church.
And the principles and ordinances of the gospel of Joseph Smith.
You can be you can be resurrected or saved.
Right, resurrected.
But if you want
eternal life
and exaltation, you have to have all your ordinances done through the church.
And that includes the temple and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, crazy. So you're active and busy and going along and putting a couple of little things on the shelf. Then what happens?
So I'm really getting into like evidence of the Book of Mormon. Like, I'm going to prove the church is true through evidence. I'm just eating up everything I can find on archaeological evidence and anything.
As a good active Mormon.
As an active Mormon. Like, okay. I'm really excited about, like, because I read somewhere, I didn't know where I read it, but I read somewhere that 100 years from Joseph Smith's time, we'll have so much evidence that the Book of Mormon's true that, you know, everyone's going to convert. Now, I don't think that quote actually exists. That was just Mormon folklore.
Yeah.
But that's what I believe.
And a hope, I suppose. Yeah.
And so I'm watching things on YouTube, and I come across this gentleman called Jake Hilton, and he has these videos on Book of Mormon archaeology in North America. And it's really good stuff. Find out later, none of this stuff was actually, you know,
true.
It's all been proven, you know, as a hoax, but I don't think he knew that either at the time. But he, so I'm following him for a while, and he created this new documentary that's calling out the LDS Church and their false heresies. And
he has that?
And I'm like, this guy, I look up to this guy. Why is he saying that these things the church is doing is wrong? And he's talking about the priesthood, that we have no right to the priesthood, you know, there's no priesthood hierarchy, and I'm like, what? That's not right. And,
oh my goodness.
So he's going through several different things, and he talks about the church building a mall. And I, at this time, I was so naive as a member, I didn't realize the church had built the big mall across the street from the temple.
Right.
And I thought, that's really wrong. And he pointed out, like, there was a gentleman that built a replica of the Ark back east.
Yeah.
And with the amount of money that was spent on this mall in Salt Lake, the church could have built over 100 of these Ark exhibits across the world and bring millions to the story of Noah's Ark. And wouldn't that be amazing?
Instead of a mall,
a shopping mall. And, yeah. And he plays this clip of Thomas S. Monson saying, "Let's go shopping." And I thought, okay, something's wrong here. And then the conference, I think it was October conference, you had the Ponderai scandal. So you had the presiding bishop of the church give this amazing talk on pondering the scriptures and then memorizing them, and it was this really crafty message, and everybody loved it. And we find out he had a whole e-commerce store. It was his son. Set up an entire e-commerce store and all this merchandise and apparel for Ponderize.
That was already set up.
That was literally live the day before General Conference. And, it blew up on the Salt Lake Tribune and made these big headlines. And anyways, that was the first major shelf item. I'm like, what are we, a corporation here? Like,
gosh, and what is this?
Profiting out over a General Conference talk and he's involved in this?
Yeah, that's funny. Is this like a year and a half ago then or so, a couple of years?
It's maybe three years ago.
Maybe two or three.
So that is when I first got opened up to the idea that our leaders have some issues and our church has some issues.
Now, are you in the bishopric at this point?
Not at this point, no.
So you're still Sunday hanging school presidency. You're still hanging in there.
But that opened me up to researching other things. And so shortly after I get into the bishopric, and I'm looking up all these heresies of the LDS Church, and I get into the Journals of Discourse. I don't know what the heck this
now,
is.
How do you have a copy, or did you have it online?
It's free to download online. I downloaded an app that has them.
Now I had them, and then I can't get them anymore.
Oh.
I changed iPads or something, and now I can't get them.
You could
maybe I'll have to check and see if I can get a new version.
Yeah, but I start reading these Journals of Discourse, and I am like 1,800 pages in just a couple days. I mean, I'm just flying through this stuff, and I am taking like
hard to believe.
I'm taking all these notes. I'm like, I've never heard this before. Like Brigham Young said, he could, since he has a higher priesthood than you, he rightfully can take your wife from you.
Yeah,
in God's eyes.
In there.
And I'm like, what is this? And this is really like upsetting me. A lot of it's around polygamy. So I start doing some searching on YouTube for polygamy.
Yeah.
And I come across a Fair Mormon video. I didn't know what Fair Mormon was.
And this is apologetics.
Apologetics, but I didn't know that.
Yeah.
And it's Brian and Laura Hells at a 2015 Fair Mormon conference talking about the polygamy and polyandry of Joseph Smith. And I'm dumbfounded. I thought it was anti-Mormon.
Oh, here it is, an apologetic.
Because they're like, Joseph Smith had 34 to 48 wives. He slept with some of them. Mm-hmm. Some of them we don't know. We hope he didn't. We think he didn't. In fact, we're trying to prove that he didn't. But it's a mess. And he had a bride of 14 years old.
Yeah, married other men's wives.
And my life.
And you're thinking it's anti-Mormon.
Yeah, and I don't believe it. So I'm like, that's anti-Mormon. Fair Mormon, anti-Mormon.
Yeah.
I've moved that out of the way, and I come across a video on YouTube that says, 10 books Mormons should never read. I'm like, purchase.
Oh. You bought all 10?
I bought all 10. And there's quite a few in there. You
now,
know, B.H. Roberts. Yeah.
Well, go ahead. Finish
B.H. Roberts'
list.
Book.
The one about studies of the
studies,
Book of Mormon?
Yep, Book of Mormon Studies. Titles, it's lost me. Insider's View of Mormonism by Grant Palmer. There was In Sacred Loneliness by Todd Compton. Mormonism and the Magic Worldview by D. Michael Quinn. All these books, I buy them on Amazon. My wife was like, "Hey, what's these books you bought?" I'm like, "Oh, they're just church history books."
Oh.
And so she's like, "Okay." So I am like, I'm taking time off of work. I'm reading from sun up to sun down. I'm literally reading some books, one book a day. Like, those books are 500 to 700
yeah.
pages.
Yeah, and you're knocking them out.
And
you must be a speed reader.
I am now. I've read so much. And I just, it completely just shifted my paradigm of the church. Like, and here I'm in the bishopric, and I'm doing all this research, and one of the major issues that I come across at this point in my research, first book I pull out of the top 10 is D. Michael Quinn's Mormonism, Magic Worldview.
Yeah.
And that book really made me feel uncomfortable. I had no idea that Joseph didn't use the interpreters to translate the Book of Mormon.
And so you'd read that in there.
Yeah. And that the interpreters were two seer stones.
Yeah.
And that when Moroni returned the interpreters after Joseph lost the 116 pages, because he gave them to Martin Harris and his wife probably burned them, that he used his own seer stone that he used for treasure hunting as a seer, putting it in a hat and, you know, saying the treasure's over here, and nope, you're losing it to the guardian spirits.
Yeah, hurry, you know, it's
dig deeper, you're gonna have to sacrifice a dog.
Yeah.
Like, all this magic, and it made me feel really uncomfortable. I felt this was evil and dark.
Wow. Let's pick up this list of books. We're almost to the end of our first little visit here. Yeah, it goes fast. But I did want to ask you about what was it in your mind that, maybe we could start with this one,
yeah.
but what is it that actually allows a person, knowing that they're probably hitting on negative stuff, what allows that a person that's active and everything to jump into that? Maybe we'll let you think about that.
Well,
or do you want to answer real quick?
I thought about that a lot, and it's not just one thing. It's those cracks. It was first just the Ponderai scandal. Like, that was, I thought that was off-putting.
Yeah.
And then
just a little strange.
Yeah, a little strange, and then stumbling on things I've never learned before about polygamy that didn't sit right. Like, why did Joseph Smith marry other men's wives? And so
let's pick that up on the next visit. We'll see you next time on the Ex-Mormon Files.